Why do some of us fall in love with fire? The way it moves, changes, threatens. What forms can a fascination for fire take? From an innocent curiosity for fire shared by most children.
It gives you like a tingly feeling, you feel really nice. It just makes you feel a bit good and like lets all your anger out.
To one that is more sensual in nature.
The smell of white gas reminds me of a long evening of hard anal sex.
To the psychopath serial arsonist who has an obsession to set destructive fires.
He could have set 10,000 fires in his life.
It's the pleasure of the fires, the heat and the smoke and the smell, knowing it could get out of control at any time.
This film journeys into the many forms of pyromania. The state of mind when one doesn't set fires for revenge or money, but for the simple love of fire itself. The journey into pyromania ends in a place like this. A secure mental institution sheltered deep in the English countryside. Here we were given access to Bob. Bob is a convicted serial arsonist, serving 3 life sentences. 32 years ago, Bob heard a voice in his head telling him to burn everything down in his path.
You got a light, Mandy? Action, take 2.
Bob is the culmination point of our journey into pyromania. To appreciate his story fully, we need to start where every fascination with fire begins. Every child plays with fire at some stage. The problem starts when the parents don't stop it in time, and the firefighters have to take over. One evening's ride with the Merseyside Blue Squad demonstrates the scope of the problem.
First left opposite Ennerdale Avenue and then right.
We've been called out to a car fire, so it's anywhere around here.
When we came over, it was over there.
Sometimes you'll find that it's a false alarm, but not in these cases.
Every now and again we get a spate of car fires where we get them 1, 2, 3 times a night.
In an area of less than 1.5 million people, fire crews are called to nearly 3,000 fires a year.
Some periods will be extremely busy. Sometimes it's during the children's holidays. If the children are off school, they'll be setting fires 10 or 15 times a night.
Annually, the fires cause over £40 million in damage, 560 injuries, and at least 15 deaths. Children and juveniles are responsible for up to 80% of all the property fires, making them the most destructive class of fire setters in the world. The scale of juvenile fire setting was first recognized in the US. Psychologist Ken Feynman was one of the pioneers addressing juvenile arson.
We found that at least 50% of the arson fires in various areas were child-related. Now, ultimately, we found that some were 60 or 70% child-related, or let's say by child under 18.
You want to keep doing it and doing it and doing it because it makes you feel, it gives you like a tingly feeling, you feel really nice.
Going around, setting fire to fences, bins, anything they could see, that was flammable.
Ashley started setting fires at the age of 11 after his father left home.
I was amused by the flames, the colours and everything and the sounds. I set little paper fires at my window, spray deodorant and light them and flick them out and watch them burn. And I used to set like cars on fire.
Younger kids who feel a tremendous lacking in their home life, they feel ignored. They feel that they don't have any control. Nothing runs the way they want. And they look for something, some way to compensate for their feeling of no control.
Reese, 16, also started setting small fires after his parents split up.
when my mum got a new boyfriend, she sort of turned against me where I was living with her. That's when I started drinking and, like, smoking drugs and that. And then that's when I was going out and doing what I wanted to do.
And when they discover that setting a fire will give them control, they have tremendous feelings of power.
You want to keep doing it and doing it and doing it because it makes you feel, it gives you like a tingly feeling. You feel really nice.
And now I've got tremendous control, all in my pocket, all in my lighter, or all in my matches.
As is usual in juvenile fire setting, one of Reese's little fire experiments got out of control.
I dropped it in the bin because it burnt my hand. And one of my mates jumped in the bin and started, like, jumping in there. And it went out, you still saw smoke coming out, and it didn't look like there was nothing else in there, like no flames or anything. And we put the lid back and just put it back where it was, the bin.
Most beginner juvenile arsonists never know what's hit them until it's too late.
Then the next day, when my mate came knocking on the door, he said the doctor's been burnt down. Personally, I didn't think it was the actual doctors. Where we were standing, it looked like it was coming from behind the houses, so you couldn't tell, like, what it was. But it was, I think it was about 9:30, and I thought, like, in that doctor's area, there would have been no one there in the doctor's, because it closes early. So I thought, like, somehow I thought I could have injured someone, but then I was thinking I couldn't, because there was no one there. But it's just, you never know until you find out from the police and the fire brigade.
After Reese was arrested, he had to participate in a treatment program.
If it weren't for the course I did, I would either be like my dad and my brothers and that have said, I'd either be in prison or be dead at the moment.
Today, Reese has become friends with the local fireman. He wants to become a firefighter himself.
Instead of like going out and starting them and doing that stuff, I'd rather be in the fire brigade and put them out for myself.
Both Ashley and Reese stopped setting fires after attending a treatment program for fire setters. But there are more kids out there that cost the economy up to £1.8 billion every year in fire damage. Desperate action is being taken to deter juvenile arson from a very young age. Fire crews are now even making home visits to child fire setters in an attempt to stamp out the problem before it begins.
So what's happened to Sarah then? Why doesn't Sarah know?
She set fire to the carpet.
I know she did.
What are you going to do if you see your friend playing with lighters and matches?
I'll come and give it and go and give it.
Yeah.
And every year we get children that die in fires, okay, because they've been playing with matches and lighters.
One major category I felt was the curiosity fire setter with children. They're usually kids under 10. And they don't seem to have that problematic background that makes them vulnerable to a variety of maladaptive behaviors. They tend on occasion to be somewhat impulsive, and perhaps some of them have attentional difficulties, a little hyperactive, but there seems to be no intent to set the fire. It often seems to be accidental.
You don't want you to think that you're the only one, you're not the only boy in the whole world that's ever done it. Lots of boys, well, lots of children, but especially boys, like to play with matches and lighters. I think Tony used to do it when he was a little boy, didn't you, Tony?
I did a little bit, yeah.
Just a tiny bit.
Yeah.
That's somebody who's hurt his hand there, playing with a firework. So he's got no fingers left there. They've been blown off by playing with a firework and messing around.
Kids who go through a treatment program hardly ever set fires in the future, meaning less than 1%, probably 0.5% recidivism, which also means that we're not going to have an adult fire setter come out of that particular child.
For those who don't go through a fire setting program, there is a less destructive yet much more bizarre way to channel an obsession for fire. A childhood fascination for fire may develop into juvenile arson if not checked early on. But fire can also grow into a way of life without necessarily being destructive.
There are certain kids who might have a certain type of